People ask me, good listeners, why do I hate all the Tutsi? I say, read our history. The Tutsi were collaborators for the Belgian colonists. They stole our Hutu land. They whipped us. Now they have come back, these Tutsi rebels. They are cockroaches. They are murderers. Rwanda is our Hutu land. We are the majority. They are a minority of traitors and invaders. We will squash their infestation. We will wipe out the RPF rebels. This is RTLM, Hutu Power Radio. Stay alert. Watch your neighbors.
Anyway, Paul, I've let that cow enough now.
What are you saying, George?
Your rich cockroaches at the hotel, their money is no good to them anymore. Soon, all the Tutsis will be dead.
You do not honestly believe that you can kill them all.
And why not?
What is the actual difference between a Hutu and a Tutsi?
According to the Belgian colonists, the Tutsis are taller, more elegant. It was the Belgians that created the division. They picked people, those with thinner noses, lighter skin. They used to measure the width of people's noses. The Belgians used the Tutsis to run the country. Then when they left the power to the Hutus. And of course, the Hutus took revenge on the elite Tutsis for years of repression.
So what are you, Paul?
I am Hutu.
To understand the divisions that led to the unthinkable catastrophe, we must first understand the time Rwandans call before. Several centuries ago, three groups came to inhabit what is today Rwanda. The Twa Pygmies eventually made up only 1% of the population. The majority Hutu came to outnumber the Tutsi almost 8-1. Hutus and Tutsis were defined mainly by class and clan, not ethnicity. Generally, Hutus were peasant cultivators. Tutsis were cattle owners. The greater wealth gained from ownership of livestock helped to propel Tutsis into political power. But in pre-colonial Rwanda, lines between classes were indistinct.
You're talking of a population where the vast majority has Hutu and Tutsi parentage in their background. Anybody who was a Hutu, who became prosperous enough, could ritually shed their status of being Hutu and become a Tutsi. So Tutsi was a porous identity.
Europeans who ventured to Africa in the 19th century further clouded the issue. After an expedition to Rwanda in the late 1800s, the explorer John Hanning Speke was the first to hypothesize about Tutsi superiority.
This is actually very standard 19th century Victorian racism. He describes it as the flat-nosed, flab-mouthed Negro, whom he compares to the baboon and is utterly uneducable and quite a disgrace. But then he says, but amongst them is this other group who are in every way superior. They brought in the usual tools of colonization. They brought in some guns and they brought in some administrators, but they also brought in things like calipers in order to measure the cranial capacity to determine what's a true Hutu, what's a true Tutsi. They actually had something called a nasal index by which they measured the size and shape of people's noses to determine who was racially superior and racially inferior. This is Third Reich stuff. And this was the foundational stuff of Rwanda.
For those in the audience who might not be very familiar with the history of Rwanda, which I'm not going to do because it will take us
a long time.
But in very few sentences, as you know, Rwanda is quite an ancient nation whose existence spans centuries. But for the most of its existence, Rwanda was governed by a small, because it was a kingdom, it was run by a king, and so it was run by a small elite. And particularly Tutsi elite.
So you got to go back and say, what was going on in Rwanda before 1990, before 1994? And you got to go way back, before the Belgians and before the Germans, before the white man really arrived. There were Arabs involved in Africa before that. So back, let's say, 1850, the Tutsi people were in control in Rwanda. And the Tutsi people would perpetrate massive atrocities against the Hutu people in Rwanda. They managed to control 85% of the population. The Belgians and the Germans both backed the Tutsi monarchy to control the Hutu masses. So the Hutus were slaves. There was 100 years of slavery and oppression in Rwanda. And then in 1960, by 1960, the world was seeing anti-colonial movements. And the same thing in Rwanda. The Hutu people wanted to be free, and the Tutsi people wanted to be free of the Belgians. But the Hutu people wanted to be free of the Tutsis. So you had a hierarchy. You had Hutus and Tutsis being subjugated by the Belgians, and under that you had the Tutsis subjugating the Hutus. The important part of this story is that from 1960 to 1990, these Tutsis who were forced out of Rwanda in 1959, 1960, 1961, they kept coming back and attacking, committing atrocities. But it was always these Tutsi elite, armed from the outside, coming in to try to take control of the Hutus and take back Rwanda.
And today I'm joined on the line by Christopher Black, a well-known international criminal lawyer. He is the author of numerous articles on what really happened in Rwanda, including The Dallaire Genocide Facts, A Fabrication. Christopher Black, thank you very much for taking the time to talk with us today.
Oh, you're quite welcome. Thanks for asking me to join you.
There is not only one or two misconceptions about what really happened, but basically the entire narrative that is portrayed of what happened 20 years ago.
The Americans, especially in Rwanda, denied they had any involvement. And in fact, it turns out that they had a leading role and a direct military role in those events in 1994. That's what led me into it. Most people don't realize that the war didn't just take place in 1994. The war began in October, on October 1st, 1990, when the Ugandan army, in the form of the Rwandan Patriotic Front, that's what they call themselves, the Ugandan army attacked Rwanda while President Habyarimana was in Washington. The RPF during this time is still planting mines and bombs and bus stations and booby trap grenades and markets and so on. They're killing people everywhere. In February 1993, they launched a big offensive in the north of the country against a town called Ruhengeri, in which in 2 weeks they killed 40,000 Hutu civilians. And the attack caused a lot of ethnic division between the Tutsis and the Hutus, which had died down over the previous 20 years. So the attack exacerbated a lot of hidden problems or created problems which didn't exist before. Army literally runs out of ammunition, run down an actual last bullet. So the General Bizimungu gave an order for a general retreat. So they retreated intact, in order, into the Congo. That's the only way they could go. And they hoped the Congolese government would allow them to keep their arms so they could keep fighting, but when they got into Goma, they were disarmed. And about 2 or 3 million Hutu refugees fled with them because they were afraid that they were all going to be slaughtered. And in fact, many were. We now know from studies by Professors Davenport and Stamm at the University of Michigan, based on prosecution figures, that two-thirds of the dead are Hutus, at least. This is an important story because it shows how the propaganda system works and how people's minds in the West are manipulated to accept these wars.
I, William Jefferson Clinton, do solemnly swear and defend the Constitution of the United States.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Men was called the Network, and they were working for the then President Paul Kagame, and they said that they'd been given the job to shoot down President Habyarimana's aircraft, and they said that on April 6, 1994, they were in Kigali in a number of sites around the capital, and as Habyarimana's aircraft came into land, they said they fired surface-to-air missiles and shot the aircraft down. Kadama Abor was at the other end of the line in The Hague, the American embassy. I had a communication with her, informed her of the information that we had learnt in Kigali about the role of President Kagame and his special team. At that time, she was very positive. The only thing that she did say was that it was consistent with some other information which she said she had just learned of in The Hague, pointing to the same people that I'd been told were responsible for the attack. A few days later, I was in a meeting with Judge Arbour, and at that meeting, she was very aggressive, challenged me on the source of the information, and effectively ordered me to shut the investigation down. No one has ever successfully spoken to Madame of Arbour about this. She has never spoken publicly about her reasoning.
The French were there because of its relationship, because of the French relationship with the Rwandan government, who did not have a relationship with the Rwandan government, were the Western powers other than France, the United States, who were interested in regime change, because United States policy was regime change.
These are the refugee populations outside of the country by December 1994. Again, 2 to 3 million estimation, but this doesn't include now the internal displaced numbers. These are just people that made it out of the country.
Somebody black to do it. And they took one of his top men, who he put in charge of the army just 2 weeks before, came to him and said, "Will you kill him for us?" He said, "Yes." And I want you to understand that this is a mistake I've made and many people have made through the years. We look at race traitors, which we call Mobutus, the wrong way. We look at them as if they're weak, stupid, and they're imbeciles that don't understand what's going on. We are very wrong.
Invitez-moi, il y a mille maintenant. Et l'homme de la banque. Et l'Américain.
À vos ordres, son Excellence.
Ce soir, le Zaïre a été le sujet central de tous les centres européens. Félicitations, Monsieur le Président Rabi.
Wakanda's non-interventionist policy would make it politically awkward to justify an invasion.
But what if the U.S. had to settle a border dispute?
Keep talking.
Wakanda has had a long history of tension with its neighbor, Naganda. Their strongman leader, Mobutu, would certainly take advantage of any opportunity to overthrow the Wakandan government.
Tell me more about this Mbutu, you said?
Mbutu grew up in the kind of affluence that only complete access to the national treasury can afford. He learned politics at his father's knee. That is, when he wasn't skiing in Switzerland or partying at the Bain Boucher in Paris. When it came time for Mbutu to take control of his destiny, he did it the old-fashioned way. He overthrew his father. Mbutu was always good at making friends, starting with the United States.
I get it. Business as usual. And I take it the Wakandans don't care for him.
No, they don't. They think Mbutu is a pig.
He is a pig.
Yes, but he's our pig.
Mbutu is significant because he set the stage for the exploitation from Congo for that vast period of time. It was always blamed on Mbutu as if there was nobody behind him. There's no white guys operating behind Mbutu. Have you ever seen one? Can you name a single white guy that operated behind Mbutu?
In 1996, Kagame and Museveni attack the refugee camps in Zaire with the Pentagon, with U.S. military on the ground, and they march across the Congo and they throw out Mobutu, all to get to the control of the Congo.
A million people killed in Rwanda because the United States wanted regime change. Mm-hmm. And they were going to use any means available to them to get it.
Yeah, and that issue moved over into Congo. I know you've spoken about that. And at the bottom, it seems to be things like coltan, which, by the way, when all this started, I didn't know what coltan was.
Now with our mobile phones, we can't do without it, right?
That's right. I mean, you know, in our everyday life, we're using coltan. You extract the mineral and you pay nothing for it and you get it for free.
It's the richest country in the world in terms of raw materials.
Central Africa clearly dominates the world's cobalt supply picture, see figure 3. Zaire leads by far, both in the mining of cobalt-bearing ore and in cobalt production, accounting for 53% of the world's supply of refined cobalt in 1979, virtually all of it from its own mine production. The vulnerability of the United States to disruptions in the supply of imported materials considered essential to industrial production has been of concern to policymakers throughout the post-World War II era. Cobalt is a prime example of such a strategic mineral. Cobalt alloys are important to a number of U.S. industries, especially aerospace and defense, and short-run opportunities for substitution are limited. The bulk of the world's supply of cobalt originates in Central Africa, primarily Zaire and Zambia, which hold 64% of the world's known cobalt reserves.
Since 1996, at least 6 million people have died in the eastern Congo, half of them children below the age of 5. It's by far the biggest slaughter of human beings since the Second World War. The corporate media would have you believe that this Holocaust is the result of African people's inability to govern themselves. But it is the United States that has armed, financed, and protected those most responsible for the genocide.
Leaders, and the Renaissance leaders were Museveni. Paul Kagame was deemed by the U.S. State Department, the leaders of the United States foreign policy apparatus, as Renaissance leaders.
An analysis of the ethnic breakdown of the current Rwandan government shows Tutsis hold a preponderant percentage of senior positions. Hutus in very senior positions often hold relatively little real authority, and are commonly twinned with senior Tutsis who exercise real power. The 28-member cabinet is evenly split among Tutsis and Hutus, but most key ministries are in the hands of Tutsis. While the Rwandan government presents itself as a champion of national unity and equal opportunity,
now on our top story, Dr. Jendayi Fraser is a former American Assistant Secretary of State for African Affairs. She's now a professor at Carnegie Mellon University. Dr. Fraser, Professor Fraser, thanks very much. Rwanda is often accused, of course, of trying to keep Congo unstable in order to exploit its mineral wealth. I mean, the country does have some troublesome neighbors, to put it politely, doesn't it? What more could be done to bring them on side?
Mineral resources.
As reported at the time in Africa Mining Intelligence, Kigali, future minerals trading platform in East Africa that will deal initially with farm goods and minerals covering the entire Great Lakes region, will be set up in Kigali, capital of Rwanda. The inauguration of the East African Exchange will be seen to by a consortium whose most prominent figure is Jendayi Fraser, who was a U.S. Assistant Secretary of State for African Affairs under George W. Bush.
Condoleezza Rice and Colin Powell were warmongers and liars. If anything, Susan Rice is worse. She has been an active participant in a U.S.-Africa policy that has left 6 million Congolese dead since 1996. She supported U.S. policy in Somalia that led to what United Nations observers called the worst humanitarian crisis in Africa. And she is credited with convincing President Obama to wage a 7-month bombing campaign against Libya, which has now plunged much of North Africa into chaos. Susan Rice has more blood on her hands than Condoleezza Rice. She is the symbol and substance of evil.
Good evening, everyone. From the west side of the Berlin Wall at the Brandenburg Gate, I'm Tom Brokaw. The Brandenburg Gate, of course, is in East Berlin, and the sound that you hear and what you're seeing tonight, not hammers and sickles, but hammers and chisels as young people take down this wall bit by bit.
What is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea. A new world order where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause to achieve the universal aspirations of mankind.
Who's that? Zbig Brzezinski, if you want to get really, 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 really angry, go buy this book. It's called The Grand Chessboard, American Primacy and Its Geostrategic Objectives, written by Zbigniew Brzezinski in 1997. Control over Eurasia would almost automatically entail Africa's subordination. The three grand imperatives of imperial, listen to this, of imperial geostrategy are to prevent collusion and maintain security dependence among the vassals, to keep tributaries pliant and protected, and to keep the barbarians from coming together. The man is talking about co-opting, controlling, managing, subverting nations and peoples and economies. What he's saying there is, if we don't control the world by whatever means necessary, the world's going to be miserable.
My question is this. We're all talking about double standards, but the double standard I see is, why has everyone forgotten the Congo? 5 million people have died there, and nobody's talking about genocide there. Everybody's talking about the genocide in Rwanda. I acknowledge it. It was awful. It's one of the greatest crimes in the last century. And yet, right across the border, millions of people have died, and no one is talking about it.
Kagame did not come riding in to stop killing in 1994. His gang invaded Rwanda in 1990, 4 years before, to begin the genocide. He orchestrated and accomplished much of the killing, including killing of Tutsis by Hutus and by his own men. The evidence suggests more Hutus than Tutsis were killed. That was from 1990 until the end of 1994. He continued beyond this in Rwanda and in Congo.
Mr. Paul Rusesabagina, who is the hero of the film Hotel Rwanda, has written to the International Tribunal in Arusha and saying, why haven't they brought to justice those members of the present government of Mr. Kagame for crimes there? He says that you can't have reconciliation if you're not going to charge people on either side who committed crimes.
And this is the Congo River.
This is my third visit to the region this year.
Hi.
I've been coming here to learn about the Congo because I don't want to involve myself without first understanding what I'm getting involved in.
My objective.
Learning here means meeting with warlords, some accused of atrocities, spending time in refugee camps, talking with aid workers, being with those whose every day is a struggle to survive. I'm not affiliated with any aid agency. I'm not any kind of ambassador. I'm not going to give you a history lesson. Among other reasons, I wouldn't be qualified. I simply want to share what I've seen, the stories that have moved me, shocked me, and helped me begin to understand one of the world's great humanitarian disasters.
Hi, I'm a Mac.
And I'm a PC.
In this mock ad, the activist group Enough exposes what it calls a dirty little secret about everyday devices from laptops to cell phones that contain materials from the Congo.
A lot of this stuff comes all the way from the Congo, where it's been fueling the deadliest conflict in the world since World War II. 5 million killed in the past 10 years.
The group behind that message successfully fought to get a provision included in the financial reform bill signed by President Obama. It aims to cut off money to militias involved in the Civil War. Those militias illegally seize minerals, sell them, and go on to make millions, further fueling violence in the region. The new rules require transparency. If companies are using materials from the Congo, they must disclose their due diligence, ensuring that they are not using conflict minerals.
What this bill has done is basically taken a first step to addressing where these companies get their raw materials and ensuring that the raw materials don't cause terrible conflict in faraway places for our convenience.
A big supporter, Republican Senator Sam Brownback of Kansas. He voted against the financial reform bill, but he was responsible for attaching the amendment, saying he hopes it will bring accountability and transparency to the supply chain of minerals used in the manufacturing of many electronic devices.
Hello there, I am Jeremiah Wright, Pastor Emeritus of Trinity United Church of Christ in Chicago, and I'm joining in with a host of thousands who are breaking the silence about the Democratic Republic of the Congo. We're breaking the silence about the 6 million plus who have died. We're breaking the silence about black women in the Congo who are raped daily. We're breaking the silence about coltan and about those chemicals that are used, those minerals, pardon me, that are used for our iPhones, iPads, all of our computers, that most of us have no clue about in terms of how we are aiding and abetting the pain and suffering of the Congolese. We're breaking that silence to make people aware of that and to do something about it for positive change to make life better for them.
Greetings. In the past, I have shared with you
some reports about Rwanda and the Democratic Republic of Congo. Now, today, more information has been provided. This information is coming from various sources. One of the primary sources is Chris Black. You're going to hear this information, along with just a little bit of commentary and research from myself. Paul Kagame, it appears, was complicit in the deaths of the president of Rwanda as well as the president of Burundi, according to the findings in these reports. Now, as well, the United States government was also complicit in this. At that time, the president was Bill Clinton.
This decision by the UK government just acknowledges what a lot of people have been saying for a long time, and that is that Rwanda is actively involved in the M23 movement. Why is the State Department so much more reticent to acknowledge this openly?
Well, acknowledgement and an accusation aren't the same thing. I don't know whether the Rwandan government is or is not involved in supporting M23. I think that the key issue here is to really look forward and try to see how to resolve this.
Just going back to your comment, you don't know whether Rwanda is involved with M23 at all. Could you clarify what it is that is causing you either confusion or giving you pause in making a decision?
I don't even know who the experts are. There's this cloud of anonymity about who these experts are and what their agenda is. What I do know is that there's a humanitarian crisis in the region, and that this movement of rebel forces,
right, okay,
and negative
forces, as I say, we'll get onto that. We'll get onto that in
horrific
a moment. But the other members of the State Department, let me just throw a couple of names at you who you're very familiar with, I'm sure. Assistant Secretary of State Johnny Carson, Special Envoy Barry Walkley. Both of those have said that they think that Kagame is involved with the M23 movement. The UN, as
would,
we say,
I
have done so.
You,
the UK has acknowledged publicly that there is a problem here. So again, I mean, I would ask you, are you suggesting that all these people are jumping to conclusions without proper evidence?
Almost two decades after the Clinton administration failed to intervene in the genocide in Rwanda, the United States is coming under harsh criticism for not moving forcefully in another African crisis marked by atrocities and brutal killings, this time in Rwanda's neighbor, the Democratic Republic of Congo. Critics of the Obama administration's Africa policy have focused on the role of Susan Rice in the administration's failure to take action against the country they see as a major cause of the Congolese crisis, Rwanda. Aides to Ms. Rice acknowledge that she is close to Mr. Kagame and that Mr. Kagame's government was her client when she worked at IntelliBridge, a strategic analysis firm in Washington. At a meeting with her French and British counterparts at the French mission to the United Nations, Ms. Rice objected strongly to a call by the French envoy, Gerard Araud, for explicitly naming and shaming Mr. Kagame and the Rwandan government for supporting rebel groups, and to his proposal to consider sanctions to pressure Rwanda to abandon these rebel groups. "Listen, Gerard," she said, according to the diplomat. "This is the Democratic Republic of Congo. If it weren't the M23 doing this, it would be some other group." Ms. Rice's critics say that is the crux of the problem with the American response to the crisis in Congo. It ignores, for the most part, the role played by Mr. Kagame in backing the rebel groups.
Rwanda is our next destination, and it is there the Clinton record demands the most scrutiny. Today, Rwanda is one of the biggest recipients of Western aid and support from the Clinton Foundation. But progress has been blighted by accusations of human rights abuses, both domestically and abroad. President Kagame's government has been accused of funding rebel movements in the neighboring Democratic Republic of Congo. Rwanda has consistently denied any involvement across the border. It also has its defenders, among them former British Prime Minister Tony Blair and Bill Clinton.
I support a free press in Rwanda. I don't support the repression of journalists. I don't think human rights should be violated in the Congo to protect the territorial integrity of Rwanda. But I suppose I do make more allowances for a government that has produced as much progress as that one has.
So the politics of genocide is that we're told a certain story about genocide, for example, happening in Rwanda. The propaganda system has created this story about genocide. It began with the genocide against the Jews in Nazi Germany. Of course, it wasn't only the Jews who suffered genocide or suffered violence under the hands of the Nazis, and there were more than 6 million people killed. We had maybe six million Jews, but there were also another 20 million people that were not Jewish. The whole story about genocide begins in 1945, and the politics of genocide begins there with the Nuremberg tribunals, which punished a certain group of people for war crimes and did not punish other people for war crimes. Are we led to believe that this is the first war in history where only one side committed atrocities? It's not true. The politics of genocide is that the Jews were the victims of genocide, and we should never let that happen again. From that point, from 1946 onward, this politics of genocide, concentration camps, and all of the stuff that's based on the Nazi Holocaust has turned into a virtual industry. And that industry is always pumping out the idea that the Jews are the permanent victims, and you can never criticize anyone from Israel, for example, for committing atrocities that are being committed because they're Jews and they survived the Holocaust. That's what's called, by Norman Finkelstein, victor's license. Well, we see that at work today in Rwanda as well. That's the politics of genocide. It's a very narrow, one-sided story, which to this very day is used to defend the people that did the killing and to punish the victims. To defend the people that did the killing and to punish the victims.
Rwanda, a country dominated by its dark history. The senseless barbarity of the genocide still shocks us. We think we know the story, but do we?
What the world believes and what actually happened are quite different.
Rwanda's ruled by President Kagame, but what kind of man is Paul Kagame?
The most important war criminal in office today.
Brother, the Palestinians in Gaza. They have nothing. So no court of redress has addressed the grievances of the Palestinian people.
Yeah, we want the world to go forth right now that we love the brothers and sisters in Gaza!
Reverend Jesse Jackson.
your president has vision. He sees it. He sees it.
I have the privilege of moderating a discussion that includes two individuals who have done extraordinary work in combating genocide throughout the world, as Paul Kagame is credited for putting an end to the genocide in Rwanda in 1994, and of course, Elie Wiesel is the living embodiment of the 6 million martyrs of the Holocaust.
Tony Blair's charity works with Kagame's government.
10,000 a day!
Wherever there are Tutsis, there are problems, says a Congolese man in the eastern Congo. Who are the Tutsis? Some anthropologists argue that the label is meaningless. But everyone in Rwanda, Burundi and Congo understands it. In this region, that often means the Tutsis versus the rest. Everywhere they live, the Tutsis are a small minority. In all three countries, Tutsis feel besieged. They may be few in number and surrounded by enemies, but they survive because they are clever and well-organized, whereas those who would annihilate them are corrupt and incompetent. Many non-Tutsis take a less favorable view. The street talk is that Tutsis are cunning, duplicitous and bent on regional hegemony. People in the Great Lakes region sometimes speak of the Tutsi question. Researchers associated with New York State University asked a broad sample whether they thought Tutsis were Congolese. Over 80% said no. Bewhiskered anthropologists classified them as the lost descendants of Ham, Noah's errant son.
first African-American president. I feel like that has been... I feel like you were cheated out of that. That was taken from you.
Yeah, well, I love being called the first black president.
Congolese people have to fight on multiple fronts. One, to resist a government that they believe is illegitimate and does not represent them. Number two, an invasion by at least two countries, foreign countries. And number three, the overarching power of the United States.
There are few principles that have been at play since the modern founding of the Congo in 1884, 1885. At a Berlin conference when the continent of Africa was divided up among European nations and Congo was given to King Leopold II as his own personal property. The pursuit of the Congolese people since that time has been to control and determine their own affairs. That's been the central pursuit of the Congolese people. And this probably was best exemplified with Patrice Emery Lumumba when Congolese elected him as prime minister in 1960. And he stood up and he told the world that we want Congo's wealth to be utilized for the benefit of Congolese in particular and for Africans in general. When he said that, it sent shudders through the West because what he signaled to them was that we're going to control these resources. Belgium, you're not going to control it. America, you're not going to control it. You know, United Kingdom, you're not going to control it. So as a result of that, within weeks, he was deposed by the CIA. Within months, he was assassinated by the Belgians, U.S., and Congolese sycophants. The challenge for the Congo has been internal and external, and the pursuit of the Congolese people has been to control and determine their own affairs. And they've reached out to people throughout the globe to join them in this pursuit, because Congo's challenge is not just a Congolese issue or an African issue, but as Che Guevara said when he went there in 65, it's a worldwide issue.
But this time I'm made.